Dion Win.
Hi everyone, welcome back and welcome for the very first time, and this is the sixth episode in my series So You Want to Get Into, and this series is dedicated to the directors of world cinema you may or may not know about and the best entry points and recommendations to their filmography. And so far we've discussed the work of Hong Sang-soo, Tsai Ming-lan, Nagisa Oshima, Claire Denis, Olivier Assayas, and today we are going to be focusing on the work of Abel Ferrara. You might be wondering why I've picked him, but I think he's one of the best European-style directors that America has ever produced. Well, he's produced himself, let's be honest. But he has always gone against the grain of film and has kind of broken the shackles of what independent cinema can be. And I've really delved deep into his work over the last 12, 16 months. And I think this is the best time to kind of share all my knowledge with you. And the way we're going to be doing this is I'm going to share my initial experience with Abel Ferrara, the first film I ever saw, and how the process went from there. Then we'll discuss the style, the subtext, what really makes Abel Ferrara such an outstanding director. And then I will give you three recommendations of his films. The first one will be the highest rated film on Letterboxd, and at the moment considered masterpiece. I think this is the best way to approach it, is picking the highest rated through Letterboxd. Then number two would be my personal recommendation to you, my personal favorite film of all of his work. And the third will be the all-rounder, the one that kind of encapsulates everything that Ferrara is about. So enough introducing, let's get talking. The first ever film I ever saw from Ferrara was King of New York from 1990. I didn't necessarily know who he was as a director at this early stage my film going life. But once I watched this film, I found it to be a very intriguing experience, and the way that Ferrara kind of tackles this different side of what a gangster film can be, it has a bit more of a deeper meaning to it, but I think the artistic palette was a lot more interesting than the actual narrative itself. And I found it quite strange because I was really invested in this film, but once I kind of got away from King of New York, I really got to understand a bit more of who Ferrara was. A lot of people tell you the two most popular films from him are King of New York and Bad Lieutenant, but I totally disagree. They're about mid-tier in my personal opinion, and you might not like that kind of catharsis from me, but honestly, this is how invested I have been in his work, because what I see in King of New York is this sense of trying to understand somebody. And this theme that kind of Ferrara loves to explore is the self-destruction of a human being. And this one was quite an interesting experience, but it never really grabbed me from the point I was like, wow, okay, I can see where this is going, or wow, this is a masterpiece. Some people absolutely adore this film, and I totally respect that. But once you go beyond the amazing artistry of it, what is the representation in it? I just don't totally get it. Say a couple of years ago, it was a lot more difficult to kind of acquire some of Ferrara's films. I think a few of the most popular ones were on Blu-ray or DVD, were things like Pasolini, Driller Killer, you had King of New York, Bad Lieutenant. A lot of these types of main title films, they were always around, but it took a while for me to actually dig deeper into trying to find these films. I had to VPN to some countries, I had to buy some really crappy DVDs with not the best picture quality just to really understand him. But this is what I love about Ferrara, is that he has gone out there and made his own films without really caring what happens with them. As long as it gets seen, he's not bothered. He doesn't even care about awards recognition, if it gets played at a festival. What he loves doing is just expressing himself, and I think that's what I really admire so much about him. And then once I got from King of New York, I thought to myself, okay, I'm sure there's a treasure trove of things to come, and it truly became that. Now to the style and subtext of Abel Ferrara. He is a man of the Bronx who is Irish Catholic descent, but now considers himself to be a Buddhist. And there's quite a bit of religious connotation in his work, and you get to see it in quite a lot of the titles that you see. And the thing is, there's no point exploring deeper into this because there's a lot of this kind of religious symbolism in each one. You just kind of have to figure it out for yourself. And this is the thing, I never really want to spoon feed all this information to you, but just keep an eye out for it because it is quite fascinating. But what he is, he's very provocative. He's controversial. There's so much urban decay. I think a lot of his films are very neo-noir and it's very raw, moody, and minimalistic also. And going through a lot of these films is quite an interesting sense of independence. And the best way to do this is to go backwards. So in 1976, he actually made a porno. He directed a pornographic film and it's called Nine Lives of Wet Pussy. I've never seen this film and I do not plan on watching it, but from people have told me, you can see this early sense of Ferrara within the connotations I've explained already. Very urban decay, neo-noir, very controversial. And as this develops, we obviously go into 1979 when Driller Killer came out, his first feature-length film. This was a massive video nasty that a lot of people didn't touch, but it has built a massive cult following. And I think it's a very entertaining film. It kind of gives you the early sense of a filmmaker kind of grasping what they're about and what they're trying to achieve. But what I think about Driller Killer more than anything else, it's a good tentpole to kind of go further. There's so many copies of it out there. It's free on YouTube. You can get an Arrow Blu-ray. So many kinds of physical media for this one. But it really just shows you how he adapts so well. But the thing is, I think he does good in all of his films because he just splices genre together. And this sense of exploring the mind of an artist and this sense of self-destruction, as we've already mentioned, is very poignant and prominent in all of his work. And then we're going into his second feature film, which we'll talk about a bit more later, but it's MS-45 in 1981. And I think this was the film that really showed me who he was, because a rape revenge film can be very pastiche, very cliche, but what I think with MS-45 is that it just really channels something quite special, but we'll talk a little bit more about that in the recommendations. But this sense of cult following that he built really gave him bigger chances then. He made a film called Fear City in 1984, China Girl in 1987, and worked with bigger actors. And I don't think that the studio-esque films were always as effective, but the sense of Ferrara is in them. I think Fear City is a perfect example of showing how maybe there's a bit more control from the studio, but Ferrara is pushing the boundaries of what he could with that film. And Fear City is a fun ride again, but it just didn't never had the deeper connotations of what MS-45 was about. What's really crucial to understand about Abel Ferrara is that he loves this exploration of the past and how the past haunts you. It kind of lingers in the background and it always kind of attacks you. And you see this quite a bit in the more prominent films like MS-45. You see it in Driller Killer, you see it in The Addiction, you see it in The Funeral, you see it in The Blackout, you see it in Nero's Hotel, you see it in Tommaso, you see it in Siberia, you see it in Pasolini. I could name 100,000s, but this kind of haunting is what lingers in the background. And I think what Ferrara does so well is he never spoon feeds the story, he never spoon feeds the history of that person. You kind of have to cipher it for yourself. And even when you go to big biopics like Pasolini, discussing one of the biggest, most interesting Italian filmmakers ever, it just gave it a lot more subtlety and a lot more poignancy. And this is what has been the interesting kind of development in the timeline of Ferrara, is that this kind of sense of self-destruction is explored in different kinds of ways. So at the beginning, it's a lot more about during the kind of impending implosion, as you will, and then as we have gone a lot further down into the modern day in your films like Siberia, like Tommaso, you see it a lot more in the aftermath and what has happened, like 444 Last Day on Earth is another prime example of kind of dealing with this self-implosion that has already happened. And Ferrara just candidly grabs you all the time. There's a sense of guerrilla filmmaking that really builds into something so effervescent and really hallucinogenic at times. His sense of blocking, cross-fading, just builds a bigger sense of ambience, and he knows how to hit a needle drop. Music, it just flourishes through his films in ways that not many directors grasp so well, but Ferrara knows the moment, and he just knows himself so well to know when to do this. When he makes a story, he just knows to hit it and hit it hard. But once we got into the 1990s with Ferrara, these were when we saw the films of Bad Lieutenant in 92, King of New York in 1990, Body Snatchers in 1993, which is really an underestimated horror film. I personally enjoy the hell out of Body Snatchers. And again, it just shows how Ferrara can just bring his own kind of style into a bigger platform and to a wider audience. And once you kind of watch that film, sometimes you forget that his name is labeled on this, but that sense of Ferrara is in the film. And then again, in the mid-90s, there were so many good films. You had The Addiction, you had The Funeral, you had The Blackout, New Rose Hotel, four of his best films. And this again then kind of goes back into the gangster kind of mob crime, love, hate, sex. Everything is just piled into one. We're set into rooms, there's all the tension, very interesting characters. And in this time, you see Willem Dafoe being used quite a lot, Matthew Modine, and you also see Christopher Walken in his films. They've all done between 3 to 6 films with him, and they are very influential in the style of the film and really the way that it carries on. The Blackout isn't one of my recommendations, but it's one of those films that I could genuinely talk about for ages and ages because it is such a fascinating story. And this is the thing, when I was preparing for this video, I just went through this list, and generally I could easily do 2 recommendation videos about Ferrara because there's just so much to talk about. It generally baffles me how a director of this magnitude has made so many interesting films that really do grab you in so many ways and also keep the work refreshing. But what also I admire about him is that he has massive inspirations from people like Da Vinci, The Rolling Stones, Stanley Kubrick, Bob Dylan, Fassbender, your Pasolini, Woody Allen. He has just a myriad of people that inspire him and what he wants to make. And when you go through kind of the influences that have clearly been encapsulated in his films, you think to yourself, wow, he has made some interesting things, but also he's a very well-educated filmmaker. And he's not a filmmaker of the variety of Martin Scorsese, but he is definitely more of the grittier version of what Scorsese is, because he really grabs New York in a very different way to what Scorsese does. And while it might not be pretty and beautiful, he kind of just shows another side to New York that we know, but Ferrara just takes it to the next level. Going into the mid-2000s to the present day, we see, again, a lot of unique kind of films. Go-Go Tales kind of felt like the last film of this kind of Blackout, Funeral, Addiction era. It's from 2007. It's definitely a bit more raunchier than the other ones, but you see this director who's just still kind of looking at the past but also moving forward. But once we move forward, we get some bangers like 444, Last Day on Earth is a masterpiece. It is one of the most fascinating films that explores the last day on earth that you'll ever witness, and Willem Dafoe is at his best in that film. And again, this is not the recommendation, but you should definitely watch it. Then we obviously have Pasolini in 2014, where he does the biopic of one of the most unique directors that you'll ever witness, and his untimely murder in Italy. It just really is a bit more of a naturalistic approach. And Tommaso in 2019 is about rehab and trying to rebuild yourself after addiction. And again, this sense of the post-sense of self-destruction is something that really just drove that narrative so well. And it's really one of those films that is very reflective, but all of the later films until now have been very poignant, very deeply methodical. Not as aggressive, but that Ferrara ferocity is still in there. And then his most recent film, Siberian 2020, again, was one of those films that you thought to yourself, damn, this man really is still making fantastic films. But in the meantime, he's made a lot of short films. He made some interesting documentaries. There's one called Napoli, 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 which I don't want to talk about because it's just one of those documentaries you just go in and watch it. It's on Amazon Prime, usually for free, so check it out if you can. But there is so many combinations and elements within Ferrara's style that build into something that's so much wider. And through his whole filmography, while some of the titles sound the same, they're not always the same. And that's the thing about director. If you can make things that you are proud of and you feel like is refreshing to an audience, then you know that you're doing the right thing. Now then, to my recommendations. And the first one is the masterpiece of the magnum opus, according to Letterboxd, the highest ranked film of Abel Ferrara's filmography. That is MS45. I know, I was surprised to see this too, but I do not disagree with it because it is one of my personal favorites. Also, but Zoe Lund is a mute who gets assaulted by some men and takes revenge. That's the simple side of this. But it just is an interesting film that has a massive momentum for such a short length. There is a sense of moving forward and fighting your demons, which in these types of films, they can be done very badly. But I think here, because that Zoe Lund's character is a mute, we only get the bodily expression of how she's feeling or what she's planning on doing. And this sense of suspense that he builds through this silence is absolutely mesmeric. And as we go to the final sequence of this film, it is artistically insane. It is one of the best shootouts you will ever, ever see in a film. There are a few Blu-rays of this. Recently in France, there has been a Blu-ray that was released. It's about €15. And it's the same version as the Drafthouse Blu-ray, which is out of print. I'll leave a picture here for you so you can see it. And then if you need any links to get it, just let me know. But MS45 is a very deep character study that is very little in dialogue, but the impactful sense of emotion with the combination of music in the usual Ferrara controversial CD in the belly neo-noir way just shows to you the power that he has with the images that he creates. My next recommendation is my personal favorite, and this is The Addiction from 1995. This is a monochrome horror rejuvenated vampire lore film that is absolutely immensely poetically beautiful. It has that sense of horror that classics have. You're talking 1930s, 1940s, very little discussion. It's just more about the mood and the ambience of it. But the way that he lights this film and to create this world is just so interesting. And in the modern era of the mid 90s, he makes it so cool and fascinating. And Lily Taylor is the main lead in this film. And she's cold, she's cunning, it's very clever the way she kind of meanders around New York and just the steam coming from the streets and the dark lights as she comes and cross paths with Christopher Walken's character. It just oozes cool and it oozes this sense of a forgotten era, I think. And it's a very underappreciated vampire film in so many levels. It baffles me how people just do not really look at this film in the way that I do or some others. But with horror, we obviously have the umbrella term, but this really looks at addiction, about how we deal with our own demons in a very poignant and reflective way, but it gives you the entertainment that you need. And this is an Arrow Blu-ray that I have. I'll leave a picture here. But you can watch it on the Arrow channel, and it's also available on YouTube. This is the weird thing. There's so many Ferrara films available on YouTube. You can just watch a mass chunk of this filmography there. But if you haven't seen The Addiction or you don't appreciate it yet, go back and just check it out. Right then, my final recommendation, and this is the all-rounder, and I found this very difficult because a lot of his films kind of encapsulate what Ferrara is about. But I have gone for New Rose Hotel because, again, it's one of my personal favourites, but I think it's the one that if you can channel and understand what Ferrara is going for with this film, you're going to love the vast majority of his filmography. And that's how you need it. This film came out in 1998. It stars Asia Argento. It's a very hazy, erotic film. It's very perplexing. It's just a web of fascination. It's just there's a big world out there, but within the confines of the story, it's a lot smaller. But you know that this lingering sense of the big bad is just kind of dotting around the area, and it creates this interesting paranoia within the film. But I love the minimalization of the film. The colorization is so beautiful and grainy. The use of very tight close-ups is very expressive. And I think this is where he kind of hit his heights. Because when you go from films like King of New York, Bad Lieutenant, you see this kind of rugged sense of filmmaking that he makes, but it has this tender emotional side to it. But once we get to New Rose Hotel, this is kind of when it hits together and it glues so well. He uses crossfading like mad in this film, but it really works in this like abstract ambience. But it's very expressive, and it really asks you a question of what is love also, which is a very interesting kind of angle to look at, and it's something that I've not really considered before. But this film is on Amazon Prime most of the time for free. I have recently come across a media book that is available in Germany, but it's limited to 500 copies. And I've asked how many copies are left, but I don't know how many yet. But if you are looking for a copy of this, let me know and it will get the details to you. So then, that was my journey into the world of Abel Ferrara. I really hope that this has helped you, but like I said, there are so many films that you could discuss within his filmography. I could easily do another set of recommendations, and I might do later on down the line, but honestly, I have just loved going through a vast majority. I've watched 18 of his 30 titles now, and I am still learning and continue to be fascinated. It does baffle me how very little has been written about him, or the video essays or anything like that. And it's nice to see that there is a few countries now releasing his movies on Blu-ray, because a few of these films really need some restoration because they are very dated with its graininess. So I do hope that we'll see more and more as we go on. I would love to get the Blackout on Blu-ray at some point. It would be lovely. But that is all good. So I hope this was helpful, and thank you very much for watching. Thank you very much to my new subscribers, to all of my old subscribers. The love that you give to this channel is very much appreciated. And check out any of the others so you want to get into videos. Next month's one, I'm not necessarily sure who we're going for yet, but it will be an East Asian director. So we shall see how that pans out. But I hope you're all doing well and taking care of yourselves and watching plenty of good cinema. And as we normally say on this channel, Dioch, danke, obrigado, merci beaucoup, arigato, danke schön, bitte schön, all the shins. And obviously, never change. Bye-bye.